Class 9, let's continue the chapter, chapter number 3, the later Vedic Aryans. Okay, in this chapter, in today's class, we are going to do a brief comparison of the later Vedic and the early Vedic Aryans, or the later Vedic and early Vedic age, regarding the political organization, regarding the economic life, religious life. As well as we'll also discuss about the two great epics of later Vedic age. Right, children? So let's start today's class. The later Vedic period saw many changes in the political organization. We could see the emergence of Janpads. So Janpads means a large kingdom, large territories or large kingdom ruled by the kings. Right, whose powers had grown enormously. Now come to the first administrative system. The emergence of large kingdoms was associated with the growth of administrative machinery. The most important officials were the treasurer, the collector of taxes, the royal chamberlain who managed the household of the monarch, and of course the older officials of Rig Vedic age, the Purohita or Purohit, the Senani, the general, and the Gramini, leader of the village. So these were the officials. Officials means government officers or the officials who worked under the king. So first official was Purohit, and second was the general, Senani. And third is the leader of the village, that is Gramini. So these three helped king in his king's working, right? And mention is also made of Sachiv also. So Sachiv means it's a secretariat or secretary general are also there for the smooth working of the king and his court. The Sabha was gradually converted into king's court. So now come to the Rajasuya and other sacrifices. So basically there were three sacrifices or ceremonies, we can say, or sacrifices such as Rajasuya and the Vajpayee Ashwamedha were known as, very much known in later Vedic age. In the later Vedic age period, Vajpayee sacrifices was performed by a new king at the time of his coronation, at the time of his or at the time when the new king takes the throne. At that time, this coronation, the ceremony is held, that is known as coronation. So at the time this Vajpayee sacrifice was done, right? The Rajasuya sacrifice was performed to appease gods in order to ensure the material well-being of the kingdom. So the for the well-being of the kingdoms, the kings or the king performed yajana, that is known as Rajasuya, right? And for the well-being of his subjects and for the well-being of the kingdom, his kingdom. Now next is the Ashwamedha sacrifice, that was done on an occasion for a powerful kingdom to proclaim himself as a king king of kings, right? So in that time, in that occasion, he performs or he the king performs a ceremony that was known as Ashwamedha sacrifice. Okay, now come to the next. And these Rajasuya and other sacrifices like Ashwamedha and Rajasuya, Ashwamedha and Vajpayee, these ceremonies were very, very well known during, or very much in prevail during later Vedic period. Now next is comparative study of early and later Vedic period regarding their economic life. Growing importance of agriculture. So as we all know, agriculture was one of the most prominent occupation of the Aryans. In addition to yava and barley, a new crop, rihi or rice, had assumed gathered significance. The later Vedic Aryans produced not only rice but also crops like wheat, millet and sugarcane. Crafts. Now come to the crafts and occupations. There was a remarkable variety of crafts in the later Vedic age. Perhaps the most significant change was the use of iron. So iron tools, use of iron tools and iron implements in a large quantities shows the remarkable significant change in that period. Crafts such as leather working, carpentry, making of jewelry, manufacture of glass, flourished. Craft specialization had now become more common than in the early Vedic period. So the chariot making developed in as an occupation different from that of carpentry. So not only the agriculture, but we can see the development of development of irons and iron tools and weapons, and because of introductions of iron and iron implements, they had started working or making a chariot as well as making of jewelries, manufacture of glass and carpentry. Other workings were also there. Right, other occupations were also introduced. Trade and industry. Important changes can be seen in the field of trade and commerce. Commerce was made easier by the use of such a unit of value as Nishka and Satmana. Right, so the proper coins was not invented, but a type of value they used, and that was known as Nishka, Satmana, and so the type of coin like Nishka and the other unit of values like other than Nishka, Satmana and Krishnala were also used, right, for trading. Now next is a comparison between the early Vedic and later Vedic regarding their religious life, gods and goddesses. So the Rig Vedic age gods, the early Vedic age gods like Indra, Agni, Surya, they lost their prominence, and the new gods like Brahma, Vishnu and Shiv, they gained prominence, right? As well as the Brahma, the creator of the world, got prominence. Vishnu, the preserver, helped men and the gods in their distress. Shiva was regarded as Mahadeva. And the great god, Rama and Krishna, also got their prominence, and who were the incarnation of Lord Vishnu, became popular deities during the epic period, during the later Vedic period. Durga, Kali, Lakshmi and Parvati emerged as powerful or important female deities of the people during epic period. So epic period here, epic period means later Vedic period. Now next is ritual sacrifices of the later Vedic period. Okay, ritual sacrifices of the later Vedic period, the simple religious practices of early Vedic period became very ritualistic and very complicated and rigid in later Vedic period, right? And the sacrifices became the most important part of the rituals, right? And the ceremonies could be performed only by Brahmins and who were given a prominent position in the society. And many, not only that, many superstitions, beliefs in spirits, spells, black magic, charms became the part of their religion, right? And the practice of tapasya or penance occupied an important place in the religion, as well as they believed in the principles of karma. Karma means action, and moksha means salvation. That means freedom from the cycle of life. So they also believed in the principle of practicing karma, action, as well as moksha, salvations. Clear? Now next come to the philosophy of the Upanishads. So towards the end of later Vedic phase or period, a new trend is visible. So the Upanishads do not deal with the rituals or sacrifices. They only deals with the higher knowledge and explain of the relationship between individual soul and supreme, between individual soul, that means we people, we human being, with the supreme God, right? Brahma. That means Brahma. A major concept of the Upanishad is the essential unity of all religions, of all spiritual paths. That means Upanishad does not deal with the rituals or sacrifices of that period, but instead of that, it deals with the higher knowledge and the explain of the relationship between an individual with the creator Brahma, right? And it also has an philosophical aspect. Now next we have the epics. The most famous literary works of the later Vedic period were the two great epics, the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. The epics were not written at one time, this we all know. It is assumed by the scholars that the epics must have been composed in the period between 500 BC and 200 AD. Right? Okay, now come to the first epic, the Ramayana or the Ramayana. The Ramayana, this epic was written by sage Valmiki, and the central theme of the story, Ramayana, that is the story of Rama, who is pictured as an incarnation of Lord Vishnu, and Sita and as an incarnation of Goddess Lakshmi, right? Okay, Rama, so the story was like this. Rama was the eldest son of King Dashrath, who was the ruler of Kosala. With Ayodhya, its capital of his kingdom, the king wanted to appoint his eldest son, that means Rama, as a Yuvraja, right? Yuvraj or Yuvraja. But this was opposed by his second queen, Kekeyi. The king had promised her two boons. So Queen Kekeyi, she demanded that her son, that is Bharat, would be given that throne, and sent Rama into exile for how many years? 14 years, right? So in the course of wandering in the forest, Rama reached the territory near Godavari in the province called Janasthana. So in it was a colony of Rakshas who had connection with the king of kingdom of Sri Lanka, and Rama came to rescue the muni sages living near that area, that region, means near that Godavari, and killed a number of Rakshas, right, who had ill-treated the sages, that means munis. To take revenge on Rama, Ravan, the non-Aryan ruler of Sri Lanka, abducted Sita and took her to his kingdom, right? Now Rama fought against Ravana heroically and killed him and rescued Sita. So Rama returned to Ayodhya with his beloved wife Sita, and his coronation was celebrated with great rejoicing all over the kingdoms, right? So this was a whole story of Ramayana. Now next is the Mahabharata. Okay, this was the story written by sage Vedvyas. And the main story is about the conflict between the Kauravas and the Pandavas, right? Kauravas and Pandavas, and the Battle of Kurukshetra, right? Now, so the story is like this, or the story was like that Vichitra Virya, who was the ruler of Hastinapur, he had two sons, Pandu and Dhritarashtra, and Dhritarashtra was blind, right? So after the death of Vichitravirya, Pandu became the king. He had five sons known as the Pandavas. Five sons, Pandavas means five. So five sons. Pandu handed over the kingdom to his blind brother Dhritarashtra, who had 100 sons known as Kauravas, yeah, Kaurabs. All the princes were educated under Kripacharya and Dronacharya. So their masters were, the princes' masters were Kripacharya and Dronacharya. Duryodhan, the eldest of the Kauravas, felt jealous of Pandavas and planned to destroy them completely, right? So the Pandavas got only the barren tract. Barren means it's an infertile land near Delhi, and founded new capital as Indraprastha. Duryodhana was determined to destroy the Pandavas, so he invited Pandavas to the palace for a game of dice. And during the game, Yudhishthir, the eldest son, the eldest of the Pandavas, staked everything in that dice game. Everything means his palace, his brothers, as well as his wife, right? Draupadi. Everything was staked. Everything. Now, not only that, Draupadi, who was grievously insulted in the open court. The Pandavas were sent into exile for how many years? 13 years. And after completing their term of exile, they again claimed their kingdom. And Duryodhan refused to give their share of the kingdom. And this resulted in a great war between the Pandavas and the Kauravas. Right? So this is how the conflict or the war began to claim that Hastinapur, that kingdom. Now next is message of the Bhagavad Gita. When Arjuna refused to fight against his own relatives, in that time Lord Krishna gave him a divine Lord Krishna, who was the charioteer of Arjuna that time, he gave him the divine message of karma and dharma, true dharma, right, which was contained in Bhagavad Gita. So according to that, your concern, says the Gita, is solely with action, not its fruit. Action is its own reward. In the battle that lasted for 18 days, all the Kauravas brothers were killed and Yudhishthir became the king of Hastinapur. Yudhishthir, the eldest among the Pandavas, became the king of Hastinapur, right? Okay, now it is told that whenever you are in trouble, or whenever you are in wondering some answers of some questions, then that time, if you see or if you read Bhagavad Gita, you will get the solution, you will get the answers from that Bhagavad Gita, right? So in the same way, when Arjuna was like very distressed, and he refused to fight against his own relatives that time, Lord Krishna gave him divine message of true dharma, which was contained in the Bhagavad Gita, right? So in according to that Bhagavad Gita, or according to that true dharma, what did he say? He said that your concern, says the Gita, is solely with action, not its fruit. Action is its own reward, right? So that and action is its own reward. That means do your duty, but do not concern yourself with the results. You should not think about the result. If you have any responsibility, do it, right? Do not think about the result. And next is the fruits of your actions, whatever actions or whatever work you have done, the fruits or the results of that actions are not for your enjoyment. Is that clear? And next is what he taught to Arjuna, that although the nature of living being is to work, but often situation comes that or arise where work seems to be overburden or very confusing. In that time, you should not run away from that work unless you should accept it and do that work. Right? Okay. So now come to the next topic, the importance of the epics. Okay, the epics teach us many things. Number one, the epic serves as the main source of information regarding the political life, cultural life, and the social life and organization of the epic age, epic period. Secondly, we also get the information about the various Aryan kingdoms, about their armies and the weapons they used during that period, right? Next, the epics also proclaimed or gave information of their regarding their literary and the philosophical work or philosophical values. They also reveal the high ideals of family life of the Aryans, the great heroes depicted in the epics as the having a high moral principles made a great impact on successive generations. The Bhagavad Gita, which forms parts of Mahabharata, is one of the most popular religious texts considered sacred by the people of India. The interest of the self might conflict with the duty, and whenever there is such a conflict, the Gita does give the answer. So, as I already told you, whenever you are in a confusion state, or whenever you are in confusion, in that time, you just read Bhagavad Gita, you'll get the answers to your questions. Clear? Okay, that is the secret of the undying popularity of this religious text, Bhagavad Gita. It teaches that the soul is immortal. Clear? Okay. So, class 9th, we have completed this chapter, the later Vedic age. Now, soon we'll meet in the next video with the new chapter. Till then, bye bye.